evening and welcome to this edition of the Dane Chenery Show, and I'm your host, Dane Chenery. You know, this evening we have a very special guest. Her name is Judy Kanigel, and if you're into ceramics, this is the show for you. Please welcome my guest to the show. Hi, Judy.
Hi, Dane.
Hi, Judy, thank you for coming on the show.
Nice to see you, Dane. Oh.
First, tell me, how did you get into ceramics?
Well, that's a long story.
I don't know. We've got time.
Okay. Well, I used to be a school principal.
Okay.
And when a teacher was retiring, we would have an exit conference.
Okay.
And I'd always say, what do you want to do after you retire? And often they'd say, well, I've worked so hard, I just want to relax. But that gets old really fast.
Okay.
So playing with your grandkids or traveling doesn't
sooner or later, you want to pick up something else
yes.
to do. Okay, that
so
makes sense.
So I get them thinking about what they want to do, and I usually say, let me know, tell me something that you've never done that you've always wanted to do, and we'll meet again. And so they'd always come back with some idea that interested them. And when I retired, I thought, uh-oh.
It's my turn.
It's my turn.
This is my turn. Wait a minute.
Right. So I always wanted to do pottery, but when I went to art school, they didn't have a pottery class.
Okay.
So I thought, well, there you go. There's something I want to do. So I started, and I never looked back. I just fell in love and with the whole process.
What is it about working with clay, or is it the working with clay that you enjoy?
It's, well, in a way, it's meditative.
Okay.
And it's exciting to take a lump of clay, which is essentially mud, and mold it and make it into something that you want to make.
Beautiful, I might add, because I've seen your work, and you guys are going to get a chance to see her work a little bit later, but it's absolutely stunning. So you get a chance to mold with your hands. Is that a piece of the what brings enjoyment to you?
Yes. I like the idea of working on a wheel and centering. I've always been interested in centering. I did Tai Chi for 20 years, which is a centering activity. And if you're at your best, you always feel centered.
Yes.
And when I do pottery, the idea of centering the clay on the wheel is just an extension of that whole idea.
Does it absorb some of that centering energy and feed it back out to you while you're working with it, kind of?
Well, people who do pottery say if you have a bad day, it shows in your work. So maybe that's true. I'm not aware of it. I just know that when it turns out exactly the way I want it to, I feel really good and like I've accomplished something.
Well,
when I mess up, I feel terrible.
Yeah, that's the difference between a good piece of artwork and a piece of artwork that you probably won't use. Now, how do you decide what you're going to do? Or does it come to you like at night when you're sleeping, you wake up, I think I'm going to go and do this?
Sometimes I just get an idea. I'll see something that has nothing to do with pottery, but a design or a pattern or a shape. And I think, boy, that would make a nice picture, or that would make a nice vase, or maybe we need something to in the house that I don't have, a covered casserole. And so I'll just think I want to make that, or I'll be taking a class and the ideas will come from that. Like you go to a demonstration, a master class, and some artist who you've heard of for years is there sitting there talking to you and the class, and you're inspired by them.
Okay.
The problem is you don't want to copy. You want to create your own.
Right.
So you want to use their idea as a starting point. And so that's another way.
Have you gone to some of these master classes and walked away saying, oh, I just can't wait to do this, or this sounds really, I mean, do they give you new ideas on how to do things as well?
Sometimes.
Really?
Yeah.
What are some of the things that you've learned?
Well, recently, I took a class, and I can't think of his name at the moment.
That's okay.
at the Harvard Ceramic Studio. And he makes these beautiful pieces that are not standard. They're off kilter, the bottom is twisted, and the glazes are, he's very free. And I couldn't wait to make something. And then he demonstrated how to do it. We had a chance to make our own. And then you kind of take off from that. But it was very inspiring.
Now, did your piece, once you started it, did it take on that kind of shape that you were hoping or that you learned?
Nick Jerling, that's his name.
Nick Jerling. Nick, she liked your class, and she's actually doing something from it. So Nick Jerling, yes. He's a famous?
Yes.
Wow,
he works, yeah, and he came to the studio and did a demonstration, a day-long workshop, and it was very exciting. I've been to workshops in Anderson Ranch in Colorado, and Baltimore Clay Works when I lived there. And they're all exciting because somebody has been doing it for a long time. I like their work, and then you see them actually creating it. It's very exciting.
And do you follow their work, or do you look? I mean, is there like a catalog with their latest pieces that come out?
Well, nowadays I just
the internet.
Right.
The internet. The internet has it all.
And there are magazines that we subscribe to, that potters subscribe to.
Now, not only do you take master classes, but I also understand that you teach pottery.
Yes.
Let's talk about that. How did you get into teaching?
Well, people ask.
Makes sense.
And then you end up teaching.
Okay.
So I've been teaching at the community schools in Cambridge for about 15 years. So it's an after-school program for little kids. Parents are working, and rather than just have the children with a babysitter, they are learning things that are fun. So the ages vary from 4 to maybe 12.
Wow. So you have an opportunity to actually extend your knowledge and have them have like an after-school program so that they learn the craft of pottery.
Right, and sometimes I teach adult classes.
Okay.
Sometimes I teach individuals.
Which are easier to teach?
It really depends on the kids. You know, I've had 4-year-olds that are wonderful students. And I've had adults that struggle so much. They really need a lot of help.
Okay.
It's just, it really depends on the individual.
I guess when you first sit down in front of the wheel, you use a wheel, yes?
Sometimes we use a wheel.
Okay.
Sometimes we make slabs. You'll take a piece of clay and flatten it out on a board, and then you use a rolling pin.
And roll it out? Do you
roll it out like a pie dough, pie crust.
Really?
Yeah.
And then, do you cut it out, or what do you?
You cut it, yeah.
Really?
We use toothpicks or skewers from shish kebab and cut out the form that you want, and you put it together, yeah.
Ah, okay. Now I get it. Now I get it. I wasn't quite sure. Well, everything can't go on a wheel. That's number one. And you do need to design flat surfaces or different types of surfaces so you can use different material. What do you like about the painting of the artwork? Or do you like selecting colors? Or is that a part of your process?
I love the decoration.
Really?
Yeah, some people just like to throw things on a wheel and they'll make it thin and beautiful and and the actual form of it is what they're looking for. And that's not my strong suit. What I do is I enjoy decorating.
Okay.
Sometimes I impress textures in the clay.
Okay.
And sometimes I will draw pictures, scenes, or designs, and carve into the clay with a method called sgraffito.
And what exactly is that?
It's cutting into the clay, like drawing on the clay and making a slight impression. So if you paint, if you put a color on the clay, and then you use a tool, a little tiny loop tool, you can scratch through and you see the under surface. And It's indented. It's hard to explain.
But you don't, do you cut all the way through it or just like enough to see? Well, I guess you do. You cut all the whole outline of the object that you're.
Well, when you're doing sgraffito, the piece is already made and you glaze it.
Okay.
And you can scratch through the glaze and see the clay underneath.
So that's going, that's glaze. Now, please explain glaze to me, because I'm struggling with glaze. I thought I had glaze down pat. Is glaze what you put on the artwork for color, or is that not
glaze
how does
is
it
color.
Work?
They use a colorant, and there are all kinds of glazes. I mean, you'd have to take 10 courses.
Just to learn about glaze.
Yeah, right,
that's why I'm so confused about it.
Some people use mason stains.
Okay.
And that's like a powdered, colored powder. And mix it with glaze materials. And they're usually in a powdered form.
Mm-hmm.
And you measure them on a scale, very balanced scale, like it might 2 grams or 5,000 grams, or depending upon the size that you're making. And the number has to come add up to 100%. So it's 10% of this and 40% of that makes 60%.
Right.
So you need 40 more percent to make 100.
Now, are these, if you're making 100 of different parts, do these parts combine together make one color?
One color.
Okay.
And it's very easy not to know what you're doing. So I usually use standard glazes that have been tested by other people.
Okay.
And sometimes I'll mix glazes together next to each other or on top of each other and then carve through so you see the underglaze.
Mm-hmm.
Or I'll use a wax resist. I'll do an underglaze, a color, and then I'll put another color on top. But before I put the other color on, I'll draw a design with wax.
Uh-huh.
When I put the color on top, the wax, it resists the wax.
Well, now that sounds like something you learn in a master's class. We've got to take a moment for our sponsors. And you're watching The Dane Chenery Show. Keep it locked. We'll be right back.
Real Estate Collaborative is a proud supporter of The Dane Chenery Show. Please consider our real estate institution if you have ever dreamed of a career in the lucrative and fast-paced field of real estate. Whether you're just joining the field as a sales agent or desire becoming a broker, in need of continuing educational hours, or just polishing up your real estate skills, we offer a full range of training and educational services to fit your needs. Also, take advantage of our 5% discount for the Dane Chenery Show viewers by going to our website,
Hi, everybody. I'm Judy Kanigel, and I'm here to invite you to a very special annual holiday show and sale offered by the Ceramics Program for the Office for the Arts at Harvard. It's going to be held on December the 8th from 4 to 8 p.m. That's our grand opening. And it will, if you can't make it then, you can come Friday, Saturday, or Sunday, the 9th, 10th, and 11th. We're open from 10 a.m. to 7 p.m. on those days. It's a great show. It features over 70 artists from all over the world, and they are fabulous. Everything from dinnerware to one-of-a-kind sculptures. You're invited, and I'd love to see you there.
Good evening and welcome back, and I'd like to thank our sponsors. We're sitting with Judy Kanigel, and we're going to see some of her artwork. Can you show one of her pieces, please? Now, this is the piece that I'm especially fond of, although I believe all of them are beautiful. She actually did this piece for me as a gift for a friend of mine, and it was a hit. So tell me a little bit about this artwork and how it came about, because I know the story, they don't.
Well, you came into the gallery where I sell my work, Sign of the Dove, in Porter Square, Cambridge, and you were interested in getting a present for your friend who was having a birthday. You asked for a clock. So I showed you some of the clocks that we had, and you said they're very nice, but this person collects clocks, and I want to have something really unusual. So before you walked out the store, I said, well, I also make clocks. I just don't have any right now. I've sold them all. But I pulled out my iPhone, and I found some pictures of clocks that I make, turtles and ladybugs and kind of humorous ones.
Very nice. Very nice. I mean, very nice. Look at that. So, yes. And
so you said to me, can you make a dog? And I said, sure. I think a dog's face would work perfectly. The nose can be the center and the hands could radiate. And you said, well, let me show you a picture of the dog.
The dog.
And so I looked at the picture and I said, yeah, I can do it. And you needed it by a certain date for the surprise present. So I went home and I did some sketches and looked up some pictures of the kinds of dogs that this dog was.
This is how dedicated she was to actually delivering exactly what I had asked for. So, I mean, I received like these pictures of dogs that looked like my dog, and I'm like, oh, wait a minute.
So you said, well, he has more freckles. He's lighter here and darker here, and one eye is a little bit different than the other in my original drawing. And he doesn't have a bell around his neck. He has a dog bone. And his name is Coda. And there were lots of little back and forth that we had through emails.
Yes.
And finally, we hit upon the size of the ears, the kind of color, the kind of freckles. And we agreed to go ahead.
And not only that, but you came up with the Coda clock with a K.
Right.
Brilliant. Brilliant. I'm just saying, it's brilliant.
So the whole time I was doing it, I was thinking, what if the last minute he doesn't like it because it's too dark or too light or too fat or too skinny? But it ended up that I finished it and we weren't even able to meet.
Because you were going away to teach a class.
I was on the Cape, I think, that weekend.
Yes,
that's right.
Yes,
I was
yes.
teaching a class, and then I went on the Cape. And you couldn't come the days that I was there, so I left it thinking, what if he doesn't like it?
Oh. And she left the box open. So when I got there and I opened the box, and it did come in a box, I thought, what brilliant, brilliant likeness of Coda. And I said to myself, well, once we put it up, we'll have to explain to Coda that there are two Codas now, so that Coda doesn't attack. But it is a brilliant, brilliant likeness. Fantastic work. I can't thank you enough for it. I can't thank
Great.
You enough for it. We have another piece of artwork to show you. Now, tell me a bit about these.
Well, I like making mugs. I like drinking coffee and tea. Therefore, making mugs is something. And I made these as a special order a few years ago for a 50th birthday present to a friend of someone who has purchased things from me before. And we decided on different fruit so that if you're drinking your coffee or tea with friends,
okay.
you don't accidentally pick up their cup, because if you're drinking grapes and they're drinking strawberries,
You won't mix the two. How did you come up with the different color combinations, or what made you select this color, or was it something that they wanted?
I just picked it. It just seemed right.
Now,
and I've since made others like that.
Like this?
Yeah.
Now, glaze is the grape color that you see, or is glaze not the grape color that you see?
All of the colors are glaze.
Okay.
There's something called underglaze.
Okay.
And then there's glaze. It's very complicated, as I said. So these particular pieces were made with underglaze, which
okay.
are not shiny. And you put them on, and then the sgraffito that I was talking about earlier, look at the leaves, for instance.
Okay.
You see how there's the design on the leaf is white, because when the clay was still what we call leather hard. Mm-hmm. I carved out to the surface of the clay, which is porcelain.
Now, this is Sgraffito in action.
Yes, okay. That's right. So now you can see what
this is. Sgraffito. If you're wondering what Sgraffito is, this is it. It's the carving out after the first glaze.
That's right.
Okay. Next picture, please.
This one has a story also. A woman came in and she liked my work, but mm-hmm. she wanted a particular topic. She had met a couple on a cruise when they went fishing.
Ah, okay.
And they became very good friends. And they had caught a fish. And so this couple was getting married. And she said, could you make a fish platter? So I, again, looked online and I found a bunch of pictures of fish. And I did the fish, and for decoration, I had these things that are supposed to look like waves.
Ah, very nice. Now they could have provided you with a picture, too, and you would have been able to do it, I would think, exactly like
well,
the fish.
I would try, but this, I got my own picture, and I showed it to them, and they liked it.
Is that Sgraffito?
Yes.
Also?
Yes.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. But in addition, I also put a stain inside so that the fish and the waves would show up.
Okay.
And then on the back, it says, congratulations to the name of the couple and the date that they were married. And it was a wedding present to those two people from the other couple.
What a beautiful gift.
And she.
How long does something like this take?
Well, it depends on so many things.
Okay.
It depends on the weather.
Why?
Well, if it's moist, if there's a lot of moisture in the air, it takes longer to dry.
Okay.
And if you dry it too fast, it can crack. So you have to keep it covered until it's a certain degree of dryness. You can't make it too thick.
I think this is absolutely fantastic.
Thank you. You know,
the one thing we haven't talked about is where can we find your work?
Well, twice a year, I'm in the show at Harvard Ceramic Program, the Office of the Arts at Harvard.
Okay.
And that's 224 Western Ave in Alston. And
can they buy your stuff there, or can
yes.
they just look at it like
they can look and buy.
Oh, good. Okay, they can look and buy.
Right. And then year round, I'm in a gallery called Sign of the Dove in Porter Square in Cambridge.
Okay.
That's 36 White Street in the Porter Square Shopping Center.
Okay, so that's right near Porter Square T Station, correct?
Right across the street. There's a big parking lot and all kinds of stores, a bookstore, CVS, Mudflat Gallery is there, and Sign
okay.
of the Dove.
And it's called Sign of the Dove.
Sign of the Dove.
Now, you have work there that people, like after they see this show, they can come right in and buy.
Absolutely.
Oh, good.
Or order it,
okay? I'm telling you, she does fantastic work. You saw the Coda Dog, right?
You're making me blush.
It's absolutely fantastic. Thank you. So, after you created this, what do you have working on? Are you working on something now that's kind of really got you excited?
I'm trying to think.
You got something coming up
in December.
In December.
Yes.
Right. Are you doing anything? Now, tell me about that. In December, there will be
a show mm-hmm. of over 70 artists.
Okay.
And they come from Harvard University, from the community at large, from the international community.
Okay.
And they
do. Is it ceramics strictly or?
Mostly ceramics.
Mostly
some people do glass or some other variations or multimedia.
Okay.
The show is absolutely mind-blowing. It's a very popular show. We have thousands of people that come.
Ah, okay.
And there are over 70 artists, as I said, and the work varies from dinnerware to unusual sculpture, all kinds of things. And the prices range from what anybody could afford at the specials.
The local store for the ceramics. Or...
Well, we have a special sale.
Really?
For things that people are willing to sell for...
Special price.
Special for practically nothing.
That's the specialty.
Yes, right. And then there are things that are very, very expensive, but okay. They're one-of-a-kind pieces that...
Like this.
Collectors want. And it's just a great show. I love being in it.
Mm-hmm. Is this your first year? How many years have you done this?
I've been doing pottery for 25 years.
How many years in the show?
In the show, about 15.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's why the work is so brilliant.
Thank you. Well, there's lots of things that I've thrown in the trash.
Really?
We all make mistakes.
You know, I don't want to end on that, but have you had a piece and you say, oh, this is just not working, and what do you do with it? I mean, after you glaze it or before? Because before you glaze it, can you do something to it?
There's a lot of times you can fix things.
And dump it in water and it, no, that's not how it works.
Well, again, that would take another class to explain.
But you can.
Yeah, but there are some things that I'll make and I just really love them, and mm-hmm. other things that I can't wait to get rid of. Throw it in the trash can or put it at the
just
special sale.
Anywhere but here.
Or give it to a friend who likes it.
Wow, that's brilliant. That's brilliant. So this thing at it's on December.
December the 8th is the opening.
Is the opening.
And that's from 4 to 8 p.m.
Okay.
Everyone's invited. I hope you'll come.
I would love to. I would love to.
As a special bonus, all of the participants make cups, little teeny cups that are free
okay.
for the visitors as long as we have them.
Okay.
When we run out, we run out.
Because you only make a certain amount of cups.
Right.
Okay.
But they're really nice, and
yeah,
people
they're
buy them.
One of a kind.
Yes.
I mean, yeah.
Exactly.
You're not going to get another cup like, I mean, do you ever make two of a kind? Not really?
Yeah, I'm not the kind of person that likes to make everything the same. There are what we call production potters
okay.
who can make dinner for 16 and they all look very much alike. I'd rather make one-of-a-kind things, but I do repeat a design, but it'll be a little different
right.
each time. And so the opening is one I told you, and there's refreshments.
Okay.
And 4 to 8 on the 8th, but if you can't make it on the 8th, the show runs the 9th, 10th, and 11th,
okay.
Friday, Saturday, Sunday of December, from 10 a.m. to 7 p.m.
Okay, from 10 a.m. to 7 p.m.
Yes.
The 8th is the opening.
Yes.
The 9th, the 10th, and the 11th.
Right.
And it's going to be held where?
It's held at the Ceramic Program, Office for the Arts at Harvard, 224 Western Ave in Alston.
Okay. In Austin. Gotcha.
Right.
Gotcha. And we can expect to see more beautiful work like this.
And many others.
Well, and you said there's 60.
70, sometimes 80.
Wow.
It's a big show.
It's a big show. And they come from all over.
From all over the world, actually.
Wow. That's fantastic.
Yeah.
Well, I would believe that it's sad to say we are out of time. But I'd like to thank you, Judy, for coming on the show and for bringing your beautiful work for everybody to see. And it's the Sign of the Dove.
Sign of the Dove
okay.
in Porter Square.
In Porter Square, and that's where can they go on their website? Will they see some of your work there?
Yes.
And
mm-hmm.
signofthedove.com?
I don't remember off the top of my head.
Sign of the Dove in Porter Square. Please, look her up. The
if you Google it, you'll find it.
If you Google it, you'll definitely find it. Thank you. Thank you for being a guest.
It's a pleasure.
This is Dane for the Dane Chenery Show. If you miss a minute, you miss a lot. I'd like to thank my guest Judy for coming on and talking about her beautiful work. And I'd like to thank you for watching. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next week.